talk with you a little bit about our experience with radiosurgery for benign tumors, because when we think of radiation, radiotherapy, radiosurgery, as spine oncologists, we often think about malignant disease, those tumors where we can't get an en bloc resection, they've had prior radiation therapy, they've recurred after surgery. But with radiosurgery, we are using it more and more now for benign tumors to see if we can avoid surgery. So the role of radiosurgery for the treatment of intracranial benign tumors is well established for neurosurgeons in the audience. It is a mainstay of how we treat arterial venous malformations and benign tumors such as acoustic neuromas. We are using radiosurgery for pain syndromes such as trigeminal neuralgia. And that's well accepted and used around the world, hundreds of thousands of times every year around the world. But now, although there's a lot of literature to support radiosurgery for malignant tumors, there's still a lot less experience and more controversy regarding radiosurgery for benign tumors, kind of the opposite of intracranial radiosurgery. What are the big differences between radiosurgery for malignant tumors and benign tumors? Benign lesions, as was showed this morning from the radiology lecture, they're usually intradural extramedullary lesions. They are obviously benign. We can't do a tissue diagnosis, so we need to go in and operate on them. They're very easy, amenable to open surgery. Because they're intradural, by the time they're diagnosed, they're usually compressing the spinal cord or other neural elements, and they're not really amenable to radiosurgery because you can't just target the tumor without injuring the spinal cord. So for many reasons, they need open surgery. The other is because these are benign tumors, these patients have a normal life expectancy. So you're worried if 10 or 20 years down the road, are you going to injure the spinal cord from the late effects of radiation, or can you develop malignant transformation? Can you turn a benign tumor into a malignant tumor? You're not helping the patient by doing that. What are the ones we're talking about? Excuse me. The vast majority of these are the meningiomas and the schwannomas and some neurofibromas, but we do have experience with hemangiomas and hemangioblastomas as well. What does the literature support? This was a table from a book chapter from about a year ago where we put together the experience, and I know you can't see the details, but to show you that there's a growing amount of evidence, and I'll go through some of the major talks. This was an update from our chapter, from a chapter in our textbook on spine radiosurgery, looking at these benign extramedullary tumors of the spine. This was from the Stanford experience. The first large experience was only about 10 years ago. This is the Dodd experience back in 2006 from Stanford, where they used the CyberKnife technology, but now there's a bunch of different technologies, and I'll show you how you can use different technologies to treat these lesions. But these were relatively small studies of patients, about 50 patients, but what they found is that 96% of these patients were radiographically stable or decreased. So all of a sudden, we were taking a condition where in the past we only had surgery to treat these lesions. We rarely used fractionated radiotherapy, and we could use radiosurgery to control these lesions. Then Arjun Sigal, someone who was mentioned earlier in 2007, this is experience when he was at the UCSF, showing also in these small series, once again, very small series, of patients. Most of these patients, I'll show, the 11 were post-surgical. So most of these patients are ones where they underwent surgery, they had a tissue diagnosis for whatever reason, they recurred, and they were not a candidate for a second surgery. This was the updated experience in one of the largest in the world, now the Stanford in 2011, showing for some of these patients had been followed for over 10 years very, very successfully, and showing one more time that only one of these patients increased in size and only one had a transient myelopathy at 9 months. Very, very safe, and this is an update of their series for the schwannomas and the neurofibromas in 2014. We started from very early on also treating patients, these benign patients. And if you are a spine oncologist, you see lots of these patients because as we all get older and follow our patients longer and longer, they do recur after open surgery. what have we done now in Pittsburgh? 170 lesions at one institution. Many of these are neurofibromas, schwannomas, and meningiomas. You can see with most of them are associated with type 1 or type 2 neurofibromatosis. We've done a handful of arterial venous malformations as well as hemangiomas. The vast majority of our patients, as you can imagine, are post-surgical, so the residual or recurrent after open surgery, because most of these patients require open surgery. As surgeons, we enjoy taking care of these patients because we can take out the tumors, the patients do well, and we can look the patient and the family in the eye and say the likelihood of this ever coming back is very, very small. But as I stated previously, if you follow many of these patients, or they're old enough, or they have medical comorbidities, and they're not all candidates for further surgery. And you can see in the bottom right-hand corner, the long-term pain improvement in these patients is a 90%. So many of our patients with neurofibromatosis, they're not candidates for open surgery. We can treat these with radiosurgery and improve their pain for a very long period of time. Long-term radiographic control now at 10 years, the median here of 9 years in our series is 96%, and this is with very careful follow-up. What are the types of examples? This is a young woman, 43 years old. She has this symptomatic T1 tumor with pain. You can see there, that would be a major surgery to open up her chest to take out this tumor, and she did not want surgery. We treated 14 gray in a single fraction. This was about 8 years ago now. More common, typical patient, as you can see on the left-hand side, we don't have to decide which, you know, we don't have to vote on which of these, who in the audience would open up this patient. This is a patient he's very myelopathic, had that MRI on the left side. They required an open surgery to decompress the spinal cord and get a tissue diagnosis. But there was tumor left by the other surgeon around the vertebral artery. He couldn't get it all. We followed the patients along, the tumor started growing, and we decided to treat this with radiosurgery. Prior to that, there's really no indication for open surgery surrounding the vertebral artery. You certainly don't want to sacrifice the vertebral artery in someone with a benign tumor at 49 years of age. So how do we treat this? 14 gray to the GTV, to the tumor itself, very high coverage, 99% coverage, the PTV, and we can tell that patient, we follow them along, the likelihood of growth is almost zero. And the injury to the spinal cord is exceedingly low. The risk to the vertebral artery, a vertebral artery occlusion, approximates zero. So here's a more recent patient with a schwannoma. You can see they're very difficult of eroding the bone, 16 gray in a single fraction. Pain, he had 10 out of 10 pain prior to the procedure, pain resolution within 1 month. It's very, very effective at treating this patient. This is a patient with a history of prostate cancer. Not everyone, every patient with metastatic disease, every time you see a lesion that enhances, sometimes they're benign. So this is a gentleman who's lived for years and years with prostate cancer. So an astute radiation oncologist who happened to be my wife, who's a radiation oncologist at our VA hospital, said this is probably not a prostate metastasis, so we biopsied it by our interventional radiology colleagues. It turned out to be a schwannoma. So what did we do? We treated this with 10 out of 10 radicular pain. He's 3 years still absolutely pain-free because he's followed up on a regular basis for his prostate cancer, and pain resolved within weeks. Very, very safe, very, very effective. This is a gentleman with neurofibromatosis who had three prior open surgical resections of this tumor, resected, came back, resected, came back, resected, came back. I would hope now in 2018 this patient would not undergo a fourth resection but would undergo radiosurgery, and we could treat this once again very, very safely in the cauda equina, improve their pain and long-term radiographic control. This is a gentleman who is one of our medical students, who's now a physician, has neurofibromatosis type 2, had significant progressive pain in the left S1 nerve root distribution. We treated this with radiosurgery. An open surgery for someone with NF2 for this lesion would be a very, very difficult case. How about hemangiomas? I'm always called about treating hemangiomas. I think a much better way to treat hemangiomas is with cement. And that's what we do. That's kind of our go-to, is to place cement into these patients. Occasionally, we will have patients that require open, will do radiosurgery. We can't do any open surgical procedures or even percutaneous procedures. And we've treated a handful, in our experience, about 10. We even came up with this checklist for patients with benign tumors of who are good candidates for radiosurgery. What are the current techniques? Very similar to metastatic disease and malignant tumors, but our doses are a little bit lower. The reason why we're lower, The reason why the doses are a little bit lower is we're just concerned about the spinal cord and the late effects of toxicity. So at our center and around the country, we use slightly lower doses. And how do we image these patients? Because we can't use frame-based. This is in the spine. This is the CBCT or cone beam CT imaging for intradural lesions. We've looked at our experience where we take these patients, we can set them up with sub-millimeter accuracy or accuracy within 1 millimeter is really what you need for these intradural lesions. And the way we do this is we have positioning data, as I believe was shown earlier today. This is on the Elekta Synergy system, where the patient has a diagnostic CT for contouring, and then on the treatment couch, and then we can, looking at positional, here we can look at the positioning errors in X, Y, Z, and then rotational XYZ, and then so in 6 degrees, we can correct and treat these patients very, very safely. Just a word about today in 2018, we know what the spinal cord can tolerate either with primary radiation or follow-up radiation, so we can keep the dose very, very low and take care of these patients. The contraindications are really very relative, just like the contraindications from my earlier talk about placing cement for pathologic compression fractures. What used to be a relative contraindication is no longer a contraindication. We can take these patients, we can even decrease neurologic compromise of structures, and the consideration of malignant transformation. There's never been a reported case in the literature outside of the skull of malignant transformation for one of these benign tumors. Now, just to end with, so what are we doing when I showed you that patient with a history of prostate cancer and we were treating the tumor right at the dorsal root ganglion and the pain went away? Well, what we're really doing essentially is we're doing a functional test, so a functional procedure, I should say. So the future of what we can do with these radiosurgery for these patients without cancer, but also with cancer. So many of our patients, where I trained, we did a lot of these DRES procedures and chordotomies for malignant disease. Now, we don't do that so much anymore because we use stimulators and dilaudid intrathecal pumps that like you probably use in your institution, but we can maybe get away from using those expensive technologies because what we can do with our radiosurgery beams is we can perform extracranial neuromodulation. And is this possible? Absolutely, yes. This was an earlier study that we were doing a decade ago using low-dose radiation to prevent epidural fibrosis. I know all the orthopedic surgeons here where you use, I'm sure in this hospital, using low-dose radiotherapy for heterotopic ossification before putting in hip replacements. We were using the same to prevent epidural fibrosis after recurring after failed back surgery. Now, I know John Adler has spoken at this meeting in the past, and this was some of the work that they were doing at his institution in Stanford using rhizotomies and facet ablations using radiation. Well, earlier today I talked about RFA, radio frequency ablation. You can cool it, you can burn it, but you can also give very high doses of radiation and accomplish the same things in a bloodless manner. And what are the effects of that? Well, starting in an animal model, this is a dog model looking at 90 gray in a single fraction in a dog, and you can see the histological effects. So what we've been doing is in an animal model, we developed a rat model where we look at the L5 and L6 dorsal root ganglion rats. I didn't know until I started doing this that they have 6 lumbar vertebrae and 6 DRGs. Lumbar nerve roots, and what we can do with these rats is we can take them, we can use, this is just using cone beam CT on an Elekta. It's an icon, it's like a gamma knife, it's a way to deliver radiosurgery. And I'm sure they have one here also with this. But so you can take the DRGs, and we chose, or I selected L5 and L6, and the reason is because it's right at the level of the iliac crest. So here, so I would be able to tell when I did the sectioning at the level right above and right caudal and rostral, which ones would be the DRGs that were treated. So you can see the DRGs in the rat. And then what we did was we took them, we kept alive for 3 months and then some for 6 months, and then we sacrificed them. And then you can see very beautifully, you can see the effects of the radiation to that side. And then with looking at methylene blue, you can see the difference in the nerve roots there. So what we're doing now is we're following them, the rats. There's no changes to the sensation. We have veterinarians who, it's amazing how many studies they can do, a testing they can do on the rats, to looking at the strength and sensation, no changes, but you can see these really phenomenal changes at 3 months. You can see here to the dorsal root ganglion that we're able to target with radiosurgery. And then this is looking at 6 months and the difference of, you can see the differences in the DRG. So the plan will be in the future, we can take our patients, especially the neurofibroma patients or some of our cancer patients that have large painful malignancies, and to get rid of their radicular pain, we can use radiation as a way to target those dorsal root ganglion. So in summary, as physicians, we have to be open to the fact that patients will demand alternative treatments to open surgery, especially if they are paying for their care both directly and indirectly. Our patients now in Western Pennsylvania, they're saying, if I have a choice between a cheaper operation and a large operation, they can't take time off from work, many of them, because they could lose their job, so they can't take off work to do an open resection of a tumor, or if it comes back from further surgery, so we can treat these patients with radiosurgery instead. So we have to be, as clinicians, we have to be open to these other alternative therapies. Thank you very much.